The second session is on neurodevelopmental disorders, or would you rather put your good old cap on, which will be conducted by Dr. John Vijayasagar Komu. The chairpersons for the session are Dr. Savita Malhotra and Dr. Nidhi Chauhan. Dr. Malhotra is finding it difficult to join. So meanwhile, I would like to introduce Dr. Nidhi Chauhan, who's an assistant professor in psychiatry in PGIMER Chandigarh. Her areas of interest are child and adolescent psychiatry. She has a number of publications to her credit, including 50 research papers and 15 book chapters. And ma'am has won the Michael Hong Fellowship in 2015. I would like to hand over the mic to Dr. Nidhi Chauhan to introduce the speaker and moderate the session.
Thank you, Dr. Gopika, and good morning, all of you. And it's a proud privilege for me to actually co-chair with Dr. Savita, who will probably join in some time, and to introduce the speaker, who is a renowned child psychiatrist, head of department from Child Psychiatry Unit in NIMHANS. So,
well done indeed.
His areas of specialization are autism spectrum disorder, adolescent mental health, child abuse, specific learning disorders, and pediatric psychopharmacology. He has a number of publications to his credit, around 80 journal articles and 8 book chapters. And he's a recipient of many awards and fellowships. Dr. S.S. Jayaram Award for the best research paper in IPS South Zone 2007. He has also received the Indo-USA Fogarty Fellowship at University of Florida in the USA in 2014. He was granted the Travel Award for first regional IMFAR Shanghai in 2015, and he is the affiliate faculty of School of Biological and Population Sciences, Oregon in USA. Sir, I invite you for your presentation on the topic, neurodevelopmental disorders, or would you rather put your good old cap on?
Good morning to one and all. At the outset, I thank Professor Debashish Basu and the organizing team for having invited me for this prestigious PGI Foundation academic event. And my topic for today is neurodevelopmental disorders, or would you rather put your good old cap on? Next slide. So greetings from the Department of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry, NIMHANS. The learning objectives for my topic are to understand the construct of neurodevelopmental disorders, to learn about the neurodevelopmental disorder category in the ICD-11, and to critique the construct of neurodevelopmental disorders in ICD-11 in comparison to the older conceptualizations. So I would like to declare that I have obtained permission from the director of NIMHANS to be a resource person in this event. No other conflict of interest to declare. When we look at the construct of neurodevelopmental disorders, these are a group of heterogeneous clinical syndromes in which the neurobiological development is impaired. And they clinically present with a history of developmental delay or deviance. Onset of these conditions is usually in the early developmental period. And these conditions are characterized by persistence across the lifespan, right from the childhood through the adolescence and adulthood into the elderly age group. Next. As a group, the neurodevelopmental disorders, they are highly comorbid between each of these disorders, and the validity is supported by this high comorbidity rates between the disorders. And also, for all these disorders, there is a clear male preponderance for occurrence of these conditions, whether it's speech and language disorders, or whether it's autism spectrum disorders or intellectual developmental disorders. So the etiological substrates of all these disorders are very diverse. It ranges from environmental disruptions to genetically determined syndromes. Next. So we will briefly look at the grouping of the neurodevelopmental disorders as per the ICD-11. As you can see on the slide, there are several disorders. Disorders of intellectual development, disorders of the developmental speech and language disorders, autism spectrum disorders, developmental learning disorders, developmental motor coordination disorder, attention deficit hyperactive disorder, stereotype movement disorders, and the other category. Next. So the intellectual disability has been termed as disorder of intellectual development, DID, in the ICD-11. As per ICD-11, there should be significantly below average intellectual functioning and adaptive behavior based on appropriately normed individually administered standardized tests. And also, like in the earlier classifications, there is a categorization, mild, moderate, severe, profound, and unspecified. ICD-11 introduces a subcategory of provisional developmental disorder of intellectual development for children who are below the age of 4 years, specifically this age group where they may present with delay of all the developmental domains, but carrying out assessments for these very young children is difficult in the clinical settings. So the provisional kind of label is given. Also, there is a unique concept of behavioral indicators when standardized tests are not feasible. So this particular concept of behavioral indicators, the validity is being tested in the field trials. Recently, some of the field trials have been completed and results are awaited. So this concept is very useful in the low and middle income countries where we see that there is a lot of challenges when we have to do the standardized tests for measurement of IQ as well as the assessment of adaptive behavior. Also, in the definition, they highlight the inclusion of a comprehensive assessment of executive functions along with the IQ. Next, moving on to the attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. The duration criterion is 6 months, and the age of onset, like in the DSM-5, they have extended it to 12 years. So any child who presents with symptoms of inattention, hyperactivity, or impulsivity before the age of 12 years can be categorized as having ADHD. And there are 5 types of presentation. So predominantly inattentive presentation, predominantly hyperactive, impulsive type of presentation, combined others as well as unspecified. So the symptoms of ADHD should be observed in more than one setting. Moving over to the specific learning disorders, a term developmental learning disorders is used in ICD-11. There should be significant and persistent difficulties in the learning academic skills. Also, the performance of the child should be markedly below that expected for their chronological age and their level of intellectual functioning. Another important thing to highlight here is none of the psychiatric disorders are mentioned as exclusion criteria. However, we need to exclude sensory motor impairments, intellectual disability, neurological conditions, lack of opportunities, problem with language of instruction, and psychosocial adversity. Next. Autism spectrum disorder is a term similar to that of DSM-5. So it is used in ICD-11. And like in the case of DSM-5, we have a dyad of impairments, deficits in social communication, and restricted repertoire of behaviors and interests. There are certain qualifiers that I mentioned along with the diagnostic criteria. Presence or absence of significant intellectual impairment, and also the level of functional language. Some of the children may have a significant level of impairment of functional language, whereas others, there is no such impairment. So these are the 2 qualifiers that have been mentioned in this diagnosis. There is also a mention of loss of previously acquired language skills. We all are aware that in the clinical settings, we come across children with a diagnosis of autism spectrum disorder who present with a history of developmental regression of language skills. So this particular point that has been included in the ICD-11 helps us to make a note of this clinical presentation. Next. The specific language disorders have been classified into 3 categories: the developmental speech or language disorders, speech sound disorders where the pronunciation is affected, and speech fluency disorder where the rhythm of speech is affected. So again, there are qualifiers for this. There are qualifiers, especially for the developmental speech and language disorders, there are qualifiers like wherein there could be a pure pragmatic language skill deficits, or pure expressive language deficits are sometimes the mixed expressive and receptive language deficits. Next. So the developmental motor coordination disorder is a condition which, again, we find a mention of this condition in the DSM-4 and DSM-5. So there is a significant delay in gross and fine motor skills and impairment of coordinated motor skills. The child will present with significant clumsiness, slowness, and inaccuracy in the motor performance. And the skill repertoire is something that is markedly inferior to that of individuals' chronological age and level of intellectual functioning. The clinician has to rule out specific disorders of musculoskeletal system, disorder of intellectual development, as well as the connective tissue disorders and sensory impairments before making this diagnosis. Next. In the case of developmental speech and language disorders, there is a difficulty in understanding or producing speech and language or in using language in the context for the purpose of communication. So it should not be fully explained by anatomical and neurological abnormalities. Also, it should not be attributable to cultural, ethnic, regional, social kind of variations. Next slide. There is also inclusion of this particular category of stereotype movement disorder in the ICD-11 in the neurodevelopmental disorder group. Stereotype movement disorders are characterized by persistent presence of voluntary, repetitive, stereotype purposeless movements that arise during the early developmental period. And again, they have subclassified these kind of movements into two types. One is a non-injurious type as well as the self-injurious type of movements. Self-injurious movements can include head banging, poking of various parts of the body with sharp objects or with fingers, slapping themselves with the hands or taking any objects and hitting them on different parts of the body. Whereas the non-injurious stereotype movements can be simply rocking forward and backward or a hand movement, stereotyped hand movements, or without injuring themselves, etc. Next. There is a particular concept of neurodevelopmental continuum. What this concept alludes to is that conditions like schizophrenia as well as bipolar affective disorder also have aberrant brain development along with disorder of intellectual development or autism spectrum disorder or disorders of learning, etc. And these have to be grouped under the neurodevelopmental continuum. And there is also a lot of shared etiology, shared genetic as well as environmental risk factors. So this proponents of this model, they hypothesize that all these disorders, they lie along an etiological and developmental continuum. Next slide. Just a recap of ICD-10, we all know that there is no separate group of NDDs, neurodevelopmental disorders, in ICD-10. Term mental retardation has been used for intellectual disability in ICD-10. Term specific developmental disorder of scholastic skills has been used for specific learning disorders. And the ADHD is labeled as hyperkinetic disorder. ADHD further gets classified under the behavioral disorders in ICD-10. Also, for autism spectrum disorder, the term in ICD-10 is the pervasive developmental disorders, and it is characterized by, it is grouped into 8 subtypes. And the age of onset of autism is mentioned as less than 3 years in the ICD-10. Next. So let us just compare ICD-11 with DSM-5. The terminologies, there is a difference, slight difference, DID in ICD-11 and IDD in DSM-5. Also, the classifications in DSM-5 are based solely on the adaptive behavior, classifications into mild, moderate, severe, and profound. Intellectual functioning is more comprehensively defined by the DSM-5. In DSM-5, there is a particular category for children below the age of 5 years called global developmental delay. And whereas in ICD-11, we have mentioned that there is a provisional DID for children below the age of 4 years. And also this unique concept of behavioral indicators is included in the ICD-11, but not in the earlier DSM-5. Next. So as far as autism spectrum disorder is concerned, ICD-11 provides detailed guidelines to diagnose ASD with or without intellectual disability. And also the loss of previously acquired skills, as I mentioned, is there in the ICD-11. ICD-11 compared to DSM-5 allows more flexibility for the clinician to arrive at a threshold of the diagnosis. Next. So as far as ADHD is concerned, there are subtypes both in the DSM-5 as well as the ICD-11, but these are labeled as subtypes in DSM-5 and presentation ICD-11. The symptom requirement has been reduced for 17 years and above in the DSM-5. No such mention has been made in ICD-11. ICD-11 has other and unspecified clinical presentations. Next. So lastly, coming to a brief critique of the ICD-11 group of neurodevelopmental disorders, though there is validity of this particular clinical construct, there is a limited clinical utility, and also the term early developmental period is not clearly defined. One of the arguments is that any disorder with onset in childhood or adolescence is likely to have neurodevelopmental vulnerability. So like, say, for example, mood disorders, anxiety disorders, though they are very much related to psychosocial adversities and some of the stresses with the child will encounter over a period of time. All of those conditions, even for that matter, PTSD, conditions like PTSD, have some neurodevelopmental vulnerability. So if you have a very broad kind of inclusion, like we will have to include all those disorders, that is one argument. Then there is an exclusion criteria for the learning disorders, wherein the practical challenges in the low and middle income countries, like for example, if you talk about lack of adequate learning opportunities, all those things we have to exclude. In the low and middle income countries, it would be a challenge for the clinicians to make a diagnosis of learning disorders. The concept of behavioral indicators is yet to be validated. And earlier classifications, they supported the multi-axial system of classification that is very well suited to child psychiatry. So all the child psychiatry professionals, they are very familiar with the multi-axial classification, wherein the axis one, we used to give the psychiatric disorders. Axis two, we used to mention the developmental delays and deviances. Axis three, we used to mention the level of intellectual functioning. Axis four, any comorbid medical diagnosis. And axis five, we would include all the psychosocial adversities. So the ICD-11 currently doesn't support this kind of multi-axial system, which is very well suited for the case formulation in child and adolescent psychiatry. Next. So I would like to end by these take-home messages. ICD-11 continues the use of neurodevelopmental disorders as a separate group similar to DSM-5. Onset of these conditions is in the early developmental period and they persist across the lifespan. A lot of newer terms are introduced in the group. However, there is good validity of this group. There is significant comorbidity within the group and limited clinical utility. And also we should remember that there is a concept of neurodevelopmental continuum and whether to include other disorders, that is a question. With that, I end my presentation. Thank you.
Madam is also here. Professor Savita Malhotra is also here. Yeah, Nidhi, please.
Thank you, Dr. Vijay Sagar, for your presentation and highlighting the important points that have been raised in ICD-11. Professor Savita, ma'am, you are there.
Ma'am, you need to unmute your microphone. Yeah, now you are unmuted. Am I visible?
Hello, am I? Yeah, okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Nidhi. I would start with a huge apology on my part for not being able to join in. And I joined in only in the last 5 minutes on the presentation by Dr. John Vijay Sagar, although I was very much looking forward to this session and listening to him and learning about what ICD-11 has about what new ICD-11 has about neurodevelopmental disorders. Well, this is, I don't know, my digital illiteracy or the onslaught of digital things which we are finding hard to cope with. Well, nevertheless, I think I will do. Only thing I would like to say is that, see, I come from a time when we learned ICD-8. When I joined residency, we were at that time using ICD-8, then went through ICD-9, 10, and now 11. And what one sees is that is a huge paradigm shift. And this shift is in our thinking about these disorders. As the knowledge and research in these areas grows, our perspectives change and our thinking changes. And one which now the ICD-11 incorporates is a developmental perspective and a lifespan approach. So lifespan approach, disorders starting earlier in life, that they take precedence of priority in terms of the hierarchy of the classificatory categories. And second is the so a developmental approach, so they're starting early. Disorders and they are kind of listed in that order. And then also a paradigm shift is in terms of a dimensional approach. You know, most of the disorders earlier, which is in contrast to our earlier categorical approach. You know, where DSM-3, DSM-4, DSM-5, there is again a huge shift from categorical to dimensional. And so this is what is happening. And I suppose the newer research in the area of neurodevelopment and developmental psychopathology, but particularly cognitive functions and social emotional cognition, that has paved and opened the way for us to redefine these categories. That there is so much of an overlap, you know, as Dr. John Bisosato says, there's so much of an overlap cross conditions. I think we are far away as yet from arriving at a final method of categorizing. It reflects a confusion whether and a shifting stance that psychiatrists or all of us professionals adopt, whether to go for categorical approach or whether to go for dimensional or a lifespan approach. And we try to make a compromise by combining the two and come up with the pitfalls and limitations of both these systems. And so therefore, still in a state of flux and development, I think I would just stop here and allow Dr. Nidhi and other co-chair to kind of go ahead with the other discussion. And I don't know what the format is like, if there are question answers and things. And, Dr. John Vijayasagar, very pleasant and very happy to see you today.
Thank you.
Yeah, on the virtual platform, and listening to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. John, we have a question from one of our DM students in the department, Dr. Yes, Himani. She says that this question is with respect to the symptom onset for ADHD, comparing DSM-5 and ICD-11. Her question is, the ICD-11 requires evidence of significant inattention and or hyperactivity impulsivity symptoms prior to age 12, whereas DSM-5 only requires that several symptoms be present prior to age 12. So she wants to ask, what is the difference between these two and what is the rationale behind this difference in the two systems?
Yes, so if you look at the ICD-11, there are these subcategorizations of clinical presentations, and in that there is a mention of predominantly inattentive kind of presentation, predominantly hyperactive impulsive presentation, and also predominantly a combined kind of presentation. Whereas DSM-5 talks about the same things as subtypes. For the clinician to make a diagnosis of ADHD as per ICD-11, there is a clear mention that these symptoms should be present in more than one setting. And also the requirement that in the inattention kind of domain, as well as in the hyperactive impulsive domain, there should be the symptoms should be met. So I think that is to probably, in a way, I would say that the ICD-11 criteria especially in our clinical settings, would be more practical because it would ensure that we are looking for each of these subdomains, like wherein inattention, hyperactivity, impulsivity, before making a clinical diagnosis of ADHD. And then subsequently, we can subcategorize it as a combined or mixed presentation, or predominantly inattentive or predominantly hyperactive impulse. Whereas in DSM-5, the terminology is not very clear. Sometimes it can, the clinician can get confused, like probably a child who is not presenting with adequate number of hyperactive impulsive symptoms also may get diagnosed. And there is a slight risk, I would say, of over-diagnosis of ADHD if you use the DSM-5.
Thank you, sir. I would say ICD-11 is a little more liberal as compared to ICD-10 when we talk of ADHD and diagnosis of like hyperkinetic disorder in ICD-10 and ADHD in ICD-11. Because in our clinical practice, we did find a lot of difference that children would come with hyperactive, impulsive and inattentive symptoms, and we would not be able to diagnose it as hyperkinetic disorder in ICD-10. However, it would be ADHD in DSM-5. So, like the gap between DSM and ICD has narrowed down with respect to the diagnosis of ADHD per se in ICD-11 and DSM-5. So there's another question from another DM trainee, Dr. Vel Prashant. He says that several conditions that have regression as part of the presentation, and this may cut across the entire neurodevelopmental group and also even enter domains of psychotic spectrum. So is this a challenge in the nosology?
Definitely, it is going to be a challenge, madam, because as far as this loss of previously acquired skills, that mention of that under the autism spectrum disorder diagnosis, I think we need to, as clinicians, we need to see that a certain proportion of children with autism spectrum disorder, maybe around 15% or 20% of those patients, when we take the history, they may present with a history of developmental regression, especially of the speech and language skills. And sometimes there could be a associated regression of the social skills also. But we should remember that it is not limited to that. The developmental regression can happen in conditions like childhood onset schizophrenia or even primary neurological disorders, neurometabolic disorders, wherein anyone presenting with a developmental regression, either to a child psychiatrist or a developmental pediatrician or a pediatric neurologist, requires a very holistic kind of workup. Rather than just labeling the child as having autism spectrum disorder, of course, if the child has features of autism spectrum disorder, as per the ICD-11 criteria, we can make a diagnosis, but at the same time, we should not get carried away by just that particular, regression is equal to autism. It's not like that.
Thank you, sir. Probably the last question that we can take up is, the question is from Dr. Gurvinder Pal Singh. He wants to ask, what is the status of childhood onset schizophrenia in ICD-11?
So in the ICD-11, there is no specific terminology saying the childhood onset psychosis or a childhood onset schizophrenia. So schizophrenia and related psychotic disorders, they're all grouped together. And as you can see in the neurodevelopmental disorder group, there is no mention of this early onset psychosis or early onset mood disorders. So if you are going to use the ICD-11 in a child or adolescent, if they present with psychotic symptoms, we are going to make a diagnosis of schizophrenia or other psychotic disorders as per that diagnostic group, but we are not going to have any neurodevelopmental kind of categorization there.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your response. And we've almost run out of time. Savita, ma'am, for your final comments, please.
Well, I think the questions raised are very, very significant and important. And all I want to say is that all these neurodevelopmental disorders and also many other psychiatric disorders, particularly major psychiatric disorders, they are linked to neurodevelopment and adversities, vulnerabilities, starting early in life and starting from prenatal, perinatal, postnatal, and then early childhood and so on. and the developmental trajectory of the brain and the neurological functions, there are large types of variations. I mean, it can be a straight line, it can be a line, the development and then becoming flat, or then there can be regression and then some development and then becoming flat, and or there can be continued regression after the initial normal development, or very slow, you know, overall developmental level, the pace of development is very slow consistently throughout. So there are several kind of developmental trajectories that one can see. And along those trajectories are the lie our neurodevelopmental disorders or conditions that we try to kind of categorize and diagnose in psychiatry. So we are trying to kind of find appropriate labels or characterizations of a developmental process, which in the natural course of events, influenced by genetics and environmental factors, is following a very, very varied kind of a course. So I think this is a challenge, will remain a challenge, as was the question asked. And over a period of time, gradually we will, the other thing we are seeing is the gradual merging or overlapping of disorders across diagnostic categories that we see. At present, we make a distinction between schizophrenia and autism and ADHD and SLD and ID and BPAD and so on. But when we look at, Dr. John Vijayasagar also said, there is a genetic risk is shared across all these categories. So the these are not clean diagnostic categories. These are phenomenological manifestations of a developmental neurodevelopmental process, of which we are beginning to only now understand the nuances, the manifestations and the variations and so on. And we have a long way to go. And I think the only thing I would say to students of child psychiatry here is to keep your mind open. Don't close it down. Don't think that the ICD-11 is the final thing that we have arrived at. When I joined my residency, ICD-8, we were learning all the categories and we were asked to kind of, you know, diagnose patients according to that, learn all the criteria by heart and everything. And we did that very seriously. And we thought that we know psychiatry. Only a few years later, we know that, no, that's not so. I mean, it changes. And then again, it changes and again, it changes. And so at the moment, I think we are in a state that the whole kind of the area is still open, and we are only beginning to unravel the mysteries of the neurodevelopment, brain functions and its manifestations. And psychiatry deals with the manifestations of brain dysfunctions. We have a long way to go. Thank you very much, and my apologies again for having missed out on the best part of the presentation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.